Good evening.
Good evening.
We are still in the Christmas season. This is the second, tomorrow's the second Sunday after Christmas. But today we'll be observing a few days early an event we call the Epiphany. And so pay special attention to our gospel reading tonight. Let's sing our opening hymn about how Jesus shines like the sun. O morning star, how fair and bright.
Through the ages, that all nations are partakers of the promise in Jesus Christ.
Through the gospel, all people are fellow heirs of salvation and members of the same body. Yet there have been times when we have failed to live in unity, when we have failed to treat our brothers and sisters in Christ with respect and honor. Our Heavenly Father invites us to return to Him and ask for His forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have created division and discord. We have hidden the light of Christ from others. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us with the light of Christ, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, sent his Son, Jesus, into our world to shine as a light for all people, including you. Jesus has died for your sins and is risen for your righteousness. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are partakers of the promise. We are forgiven in Christ. Psalm 72. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to the royal son.
May he judge your people with righteousness and your world with justice.
Let the mountains bear prosperity for the people, and the hills in righteousness.
May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the children of the needy, and rescue the oppressed.
May they fear you while the sun endures, and as long as the moon throughout all generations.
May he rain that falls on the known grass, like showers that water the earth.
In his days may the righteous flourish, and peace abound till the moon be no more. May he have dominion from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth.
May the desert tribes bow down before him, and his enemies lick the dust.
May the kings of Tarshish and of the coastlands render him tribute. May the kings of Sheba and Seba bring gifts. May all kings fall down before him, all nations serve him.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, by the leading of a star, you made known your only begotten Son to the Gentiles. Lead us who know you by faith to enjoy in heaven the fullness of your divine presence. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's holy word.
The Old Testament reading is found in Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 6. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see, they all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be carried on the hip. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and exult, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall bring good news, the praises of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is found in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. We rise in honor of the gospel. The holy gospel according to St. Matthew, the second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who is born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may come and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed on to their own country by another way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We now confess our faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we sing, "As with Gladness, Men of Old."
As they offer gifts or spare at thy cradle.
here at beautiful Savior Lutheran Church, and to all of you wherever you are, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Tonight's text is from Matthew chapter 2. When Jesus was born, the world was forever changed. The world just didn't know it yet. Mary and Joseph knew it, the shepherds knew it, and the people that they told heard about it, but it was not yet fully believed or realized. But this child was significant. Well, to say he was significant really is the biggest understatement of all of history. He came to the world, but the world did not know him. But he revealed himself to the world day by day, event by event. His baptism in the Jordan River, the calling of his disciples, miracles of healing, casting out demons, shining in glory in his transfiguration. We study and celebrate these events in a church season called Epiphany. And today we're observing a few days early, it should be on January 6th, we're beginning this season of Revelation in the event we call the Epiphany of our Lord, the revealing of the Christ, the King of Kings. And this revelation takes place through a shining star and through the curiosity of the Magi. And what we see in this event is a power shift. Keep that phrase in mind today. Power shift. That's what's happening. And Herod does not like it. And in case your Bible history is a little bit fuzzy, let me remind you that this is a different Herod than the Herod who beheaded John the Baptizer and wanted Jesus to impress him with miracles like some sort of a party trick when Jesus was on trial, and then sent him back to Pontius Pilate to be disposed of. Different Herod, but the same indifference toward the ways of God, the same disdain for the word of God, the same hunger for power, the same abuse of power. And when that power is threatened, neither Herod likes it very much. So we hear this in our text, verses 1 through 3. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Now first, these magi come to visit. These magi are often called the wise men, or sometimes you might even hear them called kings. But really, they're much more like magicians. Notice our word magic comes from the same Greek root word as magi. They were likely advisors, scholars, sorcerers, educated in a few fields, including astronomy and astrology. And in case you get those mixed up, astronomy is a study of the stars in space like a scientist. Astrology is one who looks for signs in the stars like a fortune teller. And not that we should pay attention to superstition and horoscopes and fortune tellers and false religion stuff, but here's the amazing thing. In this case, the Magi are right. Perhaps they knew the prophecy in Numbers chapter 24 that a star would rise up out of Jacob and a scepter out of Israel. A prophecy that a new king would be announced by a star. A new king, Herod thinks, is a threat to his throne. And Herod is not having it. In fact, he wants to destroy the child. And he is willing to kill all the babies and small children in Bethlehem to stay in power. And how evil is that? He's so afraid of this power shift that he would order the slaughter of innocent children and babies. How vile, how disgusting. We all, and a king especially, should desire the protection and care of the most vulnerable, the most helpless, the neediest of humans. And you can't get more helpless than a baby. Every human from the moment of conception is unique, precious, loved by God, a valuable person. And it's only evil that would order the killing of the innocents in Bethlehem. Only evil that would actually carry it out. When you understand how evil Herod is, then you understand why he was greatly disturbed at the arrival of the Magi. And if he is disturbed, well, now you see why all of Jerusalem is disturbed with him. Because if Herod the king ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. And by the way, Herod knew exactly who he was trying to kill. You may not have noticed, but the Magi asked where the king was to be born. But Herod asked his scholars where the Christ is to be born. He intentionally wants to oppose the promised Messiah. Listen, our text continues, verses 4 through 6. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, Herod inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. And they told him, in Bethlehem of Judea. For so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. A power shift from Jerusalem to Bethlehem, from Herod to the Christ, from a wolf to a shepherd. From oppressive force to the protection and care of all. From a short-lived rule of a wicked mortal man to an everlasting kingdom of an immortal and gracious Savior. And he still reigns today, King of kings and Lord of lords, and he shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And that's quite a power shift. Have you experienced it in your life? Have you been transferred out of the kingdom of darkness into his glorious light? Have you been born again, born from above, baptized in the Spirit, receiving the down payment of your salvation? Have you knelt down in gratitude before the throne of the cross? Have you eaten his body, the bread of heaven, that you may never go hungry again? Have you drunk deeply of the living water and partaken of the cup of the blood of the covenant that your sins might be washed away in a blessed flood of forgiveness? If you haven't, then repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And if you have already been brought into his kingdom, then you are experiencing the blessing of his power, his gracious reign over you. And that was a power shift for you, not from Herod's kingdom, but from Satan's kingdom for whom Herod worked. You've been redeemed from it, redeemed from death and hell. You've been lifted up out of your sins. As our epistle reading says, you have access to the kingdom of heaven and you have confidence of faith. And it's impossible to overstate the significance of it for you. In fact, to say that this is significant for you is the second greatest understatement of all of history, right after the statement that Christ was significant. And if you have experienced that power shift in your life, then why would you want to shift that power away from Christ again? Think about that. If your Lord, if your Christ, if your Savior has taken you from the devil, has delivered you, has promised you everlasting life, and if he reigns over all things for your good, why would you want to take that power back from him? Stop trying to make it on your own. Stop trying to control your own destiny. Stop trying to keep banging your head against an immovable rock. Why would you want to hold on to old sinful habits? Let go. Give your sins to God. He will forgive them. Give your troubles to God. He will strengthen you through them. Give your future to God. Let him take care of you. And give your hopes and your fears, give your dreams and your worries, give all your new goals for this new year, all of it to God. That's the ongoing, daily power shift that will do you good. Less of you, more of him. Now, Herod is unwilling to accept that shift of power. So Herod's response is spoken with a forked tongue, straight from the mouth of a serpent. Our text says in verses 7 and 8, "Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared." And you know why. He wanted to know what ages of helpless children and babies to kill. Verse 8, "And he sent them, the Magi, to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him.'" What a lie. And it's doubtful that the Magi knew it was a lie. Perhaps they would have done this disastrous thing that Herod requested. Most likely, they underestimated both the power shift that was about to happen and Herod's perverse possessiveness of power. But God intervened. God intervened. And that is a comforting thought for those of us who are in the kingdom of heaven through baptism and faith. God intervened. See, when he is at work, nothing can stop him. When he makes a promise, he keeps it. When he takes action, nothing can inhibit his momentum. And when he puts limits on Satan and strips him of power and asserts his own authority, nothing can get in his way. And when he says that we are more than conquerors because of his victory over sin and death, when he says we are more than conquerors, then we are more than conquerors. And nothing can separate us from his love. Not life, not death, not rulers, not authorities, not the past, the present, the future. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hallelujah. And as we begin a new year, let that comfort you. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he holds the scepter, and he sits on the throne, and he rules in grace for you. And that power will never go back to the shifty serpent Satan. Our text goes on, verses 9 and 10. "After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them, until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy." Now, this star that they followed was probably something extraordinary. Just recently, we saw in the sky something that happens only about every 800 years or so, a near convergence of Jupiter and Saturn. And because it was so near Christmas time, many were calling it the Christmas star. Did you go out and see it? I did. I paid attention to the right time, the right day. I went outside after dark, 45 minutes after sunset. I looked towards the southwest, looked up in the night sky, and I saw it. And it looked like a dot. Really, it did. didn't look anything too impressive to me. So I went upstairs and I got my old telescope and I brought it downstairs and I aimed it to the right place and I got it all focused and I looked through that telescope and I saw a dot next to an even fainter dot. That's what it looked like to me. It didn't look like a heavenly sign of a monumental power shift. But what did the Magi see? Frankly, we don't know. It's possible it was some sort of a natural phenomenon, like the convergence of a couple planets or a supernova, but the wording in Matthew, who says it came to rest over the place where the child was, well, that indicates it was something supernatural, inexplicable, and certainly extraordinary. And it seems appropriate that a heavenly sign would accompany a divine power shift. And the Magi rejoiced to see it. And they found the house. Yes, they were in a house, so this was not the night Jesus was born, but sometime after when they were in a house. And they found the child, and they paid him homage. Now, they probably didn't worship him in the fullest sense, like we worship our Savior, our Lord, our God, but they at least paid homage to him they knew to be the King of Israel, a king that mattered even to Gentiles, the child of the promise, the fulfillment of prophecy, a light that would dawn on the world, the Christ. And then we hear in verses 11 and 12. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. These gifts they brought were costly. They were also a fulfillment of prophecy, as we heard it prophesied in our Old Testament reading and in our psalm today. And whether the Magi knew it or not, probably not, these gifts were also a sign that the child would be prophet, priest, and king, symbolized by the myrrh and frankincense and gold, respectively. Prophet, priest, a king for you. The prophet who spoke God's word and drank the cup of bitter suffering and was anointed with myrrh in his burial. The priest who offered himself as a sweet sacrifice and now risen and ascended intercedes for you, lifting your prayers to the Father, just like the smoke of frankincense rises heavenward. And the King, who rules over all the universe and over all the earth and over your life, to give you a crown more precious than gold. And he stores up a treasure in heaven that will not perish, reserved for you. For you, who are ever thankful for the power shift that Jesus accomplished. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which transcends understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. In addition to praying for those who remain on our prayer list, we will also pray for the family and friends of Eric Richardson, who was called home to heaven a few days ago. We'll pray for Donna Lewis at the loss of two dear friends of hers in the last few days, Pat Brown and Carol Hendricks, and we'll pray for their families. We'll pray for Teresa Creamer, who is hospitalized. And we'll pray for Rodney Lewis, who lost his job. We rise for prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world. Dawn on our darkness and lend us your aid. Lord, there are many divisions in the church, divisions based on class, race, wealth, and age, divisions that need not exist. Bring unity where there is division, peace where there is discord, and reconciliation where there is conflict. Light of the world, dawn on our darkness and lend us your aid. Lord, comfort all those who are suffering in the darkness of grief. Especially we pray for the Wernsman family, the Richardson family, for Donna at the loss of her friends, and for the Brown and Hendricks families, all those also that we now name in our hearts. Comfort them with the hope and promise of the resurrection to eternal life. Light of the world, dawn on our darkness and lend us your aid. Lord, strengthen all marriages, encourage those who are single, and help us to recognize the value of each person, for your redemption stretches to all people. Light of the world, O Lord, bless all pastors, directors of Christian education, teachers, church planters, missionaries, musicians, and servants of all kinds in your church. Embolden them as they seek to reflect your light to all nations. Light of the world, Lord, look with favor upon all who are sick, injured, recovering, or are in any need. Especially, O Lord, we pray for Kurt, Teresa, Vonda, Vicky, Glenn, Hazel, Betty, Randy, Susanna, Rodney, Sharon, Christina, Hannah, Donna, Pam, Jordan, Matt, Kevin, and Ed, and all those that we now name in our hearts. Have mercy upon them and heal them according to your good and gracious will. Light of the world, Lord, shine your light of hope upon all those who are caregivers. Send them rest and peace, knowing that in you their labor is not in vain. Light of the world, Lord, we commend all these things to your caring hands, trusting in your mercy to all people. Light of the world, Lord, remember us your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated as we sing our closing hymn. Thank you. Jesus, the King of Kings, rules over you in love. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.